So I'm Piotr Prus. I'm working at Early, a small startup from Poland that is working at air quality sensors. And I'm here to tell you about Kotlin Multiplatform Mobile, KMM for short. And there are a few questions that I will try to answer during this talk. So what is the difference between KMM and other multi-platform solutions? Is it a good solution for your business and why we thought this is a good for us? How does iOS read the shared module? How much code we can actually share? And what is the most important libraries and how to use them? And is KMM production ready? And some pros and cons of KMM at the end. So here you can see the statistic from cross-platform mobile framework popularity that I found on Statista. It's from July 2021. If you have any trouble finding KMM, I'm here to help you. It's here. It's just 2%, but I hope it will increase. I know it will increase, and I will tell you why. Here are some Google trends of three most popular multi-platforms. You have seen the Flutter, Xamarin, React Native, but there is Kotlin Multiplatform as well. You see this green line there? But come on, Flutter was there also, right? And where it is right now. So where we can share, to which platform we can actually share the code? We can share to macOS, we can share to Android, JVM, Windows, Linux, iOS, JS, watchOS, tvOS, there is a lot of targets. But this is Kotlin multi-platform targets, and what is Kotlin multi-platform and what is Kotlin multi-platform mobile? So there are two things here. Kotlin multi-platform was introduced with Kotlin 1.2 in November 2017. But Kotlin multi-platform mobile is just those mobile targets of KMP, but there is a special team in JetBrains that is focusing on those targets. So they thought that they will make another product is called Kotlin Multiplatform Mobile. But essentially, this is just few targets out of KMP. So why we choose KMM for our project? Because we are a small team, and we had some issues with business logic, and we wanted to have it in one place, so have some one source of truth. I believe it promotes domain-driven development, and our domain needed single source of truth, which is good for us. And iOS needed refactor anyway. So in terms of spending a lot of time making new architecture, we introduced KMM. So now they spend a lot of time in configuration, but not coding the architecture. But before we jumped into production, we started with proof of concept. And this is our lesson learned from that. Configuration is tricky, but manageable. As you know, all of you that are using Gradle, Gradle configuration can be tricky. And KMM is not exception to that. Things that work on Android do not necessarily work on iOS. And this is something very important during the development process. The best what you can do is working simultaneously on both platforms. Because if you just convert your Android project to KMM, probably things in Kotlin will just work. But iOS, that's another story. One repository versus three repository. When we were doing proof of concept, we were making the code in one repository. There was a shared module, iOS module, and Android module. But on production, we had three repositories. And then the configuration is even more trickier. So iOS simulator is not iOS real device. There are two different targets. And this is something that we learned during proof of concept. And the sample project is not a big project. That's obvious. For proof of concept, we just use one network request and simple UI with a view model to display data, just to see if it's working, if that's something that could work for us. But it took only 1 week, two developers, iOS and Android, and 1 week of development, and we did it. So great success. How it's working right now for us? So at the beginning, we shared only network requests. It was October 21. And the rest was in native Android and iOS. Then we introduced persistence and models. So all the data classes were in share code. We went even further to share repositories and use cases. And that was OK, but we create a lot of boilerplate code in our view models on Android and iOS side. So now we introduce even view models in KMM. So the Android and iOS is doing just UI layer. And this is something that we are working on now. And we think that we'll be ready on production June, July this year. And a short recap how it looks for us. In the production code, we have domain model. Then we have repositories with persistence, networking, and stuff. Some wrappers, mappers, things like that. View models, and then we connect that to presentation layer on the iOS and Android. KMM is maybe not as popular as other frameworks, but we already have 1,137 libraries done by community or companies. And here are a few main that I'm using in the project. There are KTOR for networking, Coin for dependency injection, SQL Delight for persistence, multi-platform settings for user data, like shared preferences or user preferences in iOS. There is a serialization from Kotlin X, data time, build config to have the different configuration of the project, and Mocha resources to have resources in the shared code. A few slides about KTOR. It's made by JetBrains, it's open source, and it's lightweight and powered by coroutines. And if you are coming from Android world, it's quite easy to convert your retrofit and OK HTTP to KTOR. And here is the example. So when you think about OK HTTP and retrofit, you probably create a retrofit builder. Then you add some built URL and add interceptor for the header. This is the same thing for KTOR. We are creating HTTP client with HTTP client engine that I will talk about in next slides. And to add some headers or URL, you can have those properties like parameter and URL protocol and host. Then we would like to add the converter to make our JSON converter. So normally in retrofit we would add converter factory with JSON converter, and here we are installing the plugin that is named Content Negotiator, and we are saying explicitly what we would like to convert. And then we can install also plugin for logging that will be the same as add interceptor logging interceptor. But what about those HTTP engine and logger? That differs in platforms. So for Android, we need to add the dependency of KTOR Android, and then we need to call android.create. And for iOS, we need to call another function for another dependency. And this dependency is Darwin KTOR, and we need to use it for iOS. And for logger, we can use Android log.i, and for Android logger by default. But how we can deal with that in common code? Is there any if statement? So there is a new keyword introduced for KMM. It's exact and actual. And this is how it works. In common code, we are putting exact keyword for our function, class, field, whatever. And then for each target that we are using in multi-platform, we need to make our actual declaration of this class, function, field, or whatever. And when the Kotlin multi-platform project is built, we are using only this declaration for exact platform, so the others are not compiled. And here is how it looks for the HTTP engine and logger. So in common code, we are putting our accept vals, and in Android main and iOS main, we are making our declaration, Android create and Darwin.create. Now, one of the most important subject of KMM, how iOS and coroutines come together, how iOS can read coroutines. So there are a few frameworks that we can use. There is Eric Swift, there is Async Await for Swift 5.5, there is a callbacks, and there is Combine. So in our project, we choose Combine. We create a wrapper around Combine that I found on a TechLab blog post. TechLab is the company that is using KMM very heavily, and they are promoting KMM. They have a lot of blog posts and projects using KMM. I will not go into details about how this works because this is a Swift code. This is not my story. But this is a wrapper around flow. You can see there in the parameter flow adapter that I will show you in the next slide. So flow adapter is in Kotlin, and this is a class that takes the flow and coroutine context. And on the subscribe function, you can see that we have three functions on event, on error, and on complete that we are calling directly from the flow. And when we are using that on the Swift, in the Swift code, in the view model, for example, we are just converting this flow adapter into publisher, into combine. On every event or on error, we are just changing the published state. What was really important for us in the project was one source of truth for resources. We are targeting few languages, and that was always a bit of a pain whenever something changed. But KMM is here to help. And there is a library from Ice Rock Dev called Moco Resources. You can find it on GitHub. And basically what you can do, you can take all your XMLs and put it in your shellcode. As you can see on the left side, you are creating the module resources in your common main. You can add every XML there, and then you can just call it from your Swift UI or Compose code using references. So the Moco resources is creating, in the build time, it's creating helper class called shared res or MR. And you can call your strings and get their references ID to use in your UI. But we can do more than that. We can also give localized string from the shared module. And to use that, we need to add two string with context for Android and dot localized for iOS. But these are platform-specific code, so we cannot use that in common, but we can use our expect keyword. So what we are doing here, we are taking the string description, which is a class from Moco Resources, and then we would like to call getText to have actual localized string. But in order to do that, we need to add our actual function for Android, which is extension function over resources string description, and we are putting them up context. And for iOS, we are adding dot localized. And in that way, whenever we will call getText from our shellcode, we will actually receive the string that is localized for each platform. So how to read the KMM in those platforms? How we connect the KMM to our project. So imagine the simplest scenario where you have everything in one repository. So you can see Android app, iOS app as a separate directories, and then you have the shared module. So for Android, it's pretty simple. You are just implementing your shared project in the dependencies, and it just works. For iOS, there are a few more steps to do. You need to use, I'm using Xcode. Then you need to add the script phase in build phase, something, configuration, but hopefully it is everything you can find on Kotlin Lang documentations. There is also different way to do that. You can use plugin for Swift framework. If you would like to use it in different repositories, and then just use Cocoa Pods to insert it. But iOS built for KMM is the KMM it converts to a framework, which is in Objective-C, and this is how iOS is reading KMM Kotlin code. So what are the next steps for our project? We would like to use async await for iOS suspend functions. We would like to introduce Crashlytics and analytics in our shellcode. I already saw that there are a few libraries that are trying to deal with that. I didn't yet use it, but this is the plan. We might use KMM for web application, so then it will not be KMM. Okay, thanks. But it will be Kotlin Multiplatform. And we would like to share more assets, like images, for example. So when you think about iOS and Android every day, you probably see this. But if you would like to introduce KMM into your team, you need to picture that. Without a good team collaboration, I think implementation of KMM is impossible. Or maybe you have some very good Android developer that is also passionate about Swift. But that doesn't like, right? So is it ready for production? That is a big question. We always need to figure out between something that is in alpha and something that is deprecated. So some pros and cons. It's 100% native. Whatever you would like to do in platform code, you can still do it. You can share more or less. Android developers already know Kotlin and Gradle. You do not need to introduce them to Flutter, React Native. You can just use their knowledge about Kotlin and Gradle. And it's optional. And this is, for me, this is the biggest advantage of any other multi-platform. You can start from resources or just simple network request. You can make one test screen or one simple feature module. You do not need to make the whole application in KMM. You can really introduce that by baby steps. And what is the con? Is it still in alpha? But this is something that everyone deal on daily basis. So it's matter what this really means for you. For us, we really introduced that in baby steps. We started from network, and now we are going full in KMM, introducing even the view models. And it was working at the very beginning. Only the configuration and coroutines were something that we needed to work more, but this is how it is. And UI is written separately. This, I don't know if it's pros and cons. I think in KMM, it's a pros because you can build everything in Compose or Swift UI, and you still have this platform code in the hand of platform developers. But for some, this may be a cons, and then just use Flutter. Thank you for listening.